All right, I want to use this paper not just for the anti-cancer information it has on it, but to be able to connect some dots here. So up top, you see Complutense University out of Madrid. They're in Spain, of course. And the team that is there has Guillermo Velasco, Cristina Sanchez, Manuel Guzman. And those three names you can definitely look up as Google, YouTube, and you'll be able to find presentations by them or interviews of them there, especially on YouTube. So those are that lab in the university are the main people that GW Pharmaceuticals relies on as their inventors for the patents that they hold as anti-tumoral patents, anti-cancer patents, however you want to put it. Down at the bottom right, you're going to see that there's a researcher from Harvard that was involved in this study. And so it just shows how an American institution is already, you know, involved in this whole THC killing cancer cells or cannabinoids killing cancer cells, whether CBG, CBD, CBN, all the different cannabinoids. So there's over 100 different molecular compounds that interact with the human body. And there's about 80 cannabinoids as far as I know. And they were finding more. So I've seen some letters say over 100. But I think those are including terpenes, which are terpenoids, and flavonoids. So you got terpenes of the smells, flavonoids of the flavors. So there's a lot of stuff in there. And all those, not all of them, but much of them, have their own therapeutic effect. Like linalool, pinene, those are things like pine smell, limonene, which is like lemon smell, all those different types of stuff. So cannabis has compounds in it, as other plants that are natural and can be found in other plant families. So we're going to go ahead and get over here. I'm going to read down through the excerpts that I pulled out. Forgive me as I go through this. Sometimes I'll get caught up in the words. This is like really thick talk here. So here we go. THC, the main active component of marijuana, exerts a wide variety of biological effects by mimicking endogenous substances, the endocannabinoids. And the endocannabinoids are part of the endocannabinoid system, that bind to and activate specific cannabinoid receptors. Induction of autophagy by cannabinoids relies on the CB1 receptor activation. Autophagy is a cellular process through which, or in which, cytoplasmic materials, including organelles, which are just like little organs that are used in there, the mitochondria, and really specifically, I'm sure they're talking about the endoplasmic reticulum, which is part of the name of this whole paper that I can jump back over to, but then I'd be running around. They're sequestered over and delivered to lysosomes for degradation and recycling. This naturally happens within cells as they get age and get old. And if there's any kind of stress put on the cell and the cell realizes it's not going to survive, it'll go into autophagy, which, of course, downstream or chronologically downstream, so to speak, leads to apoptosis. So let's see what else here. Oh, yes, I guess autophagy is required for the activation of apoptosis in response to cannabinoid treatment. So, like, that's the whole deal, is it's upstream of it. So autophagy is mandatory, of course, before apoptosis takes effect, and therefore autophagy is necessary for cannabinoid treatment. Activation of autophagy-mediated cell death, or the autophagy-mediated cell death pathway, is indispensable for cannabinoid antitumoral action. Cannabinoid-evoked cell death is a crucial event in the triggering of autophagy. THC activates the autophagic cell death pathway and induces autophagy of cannabinoid-treated cells. Sorry, these are also thick. We demonstrated that THC administration, and we being the researchers, those researchers being out of Spain, who works with GW, who works with Epidiolex, who is working with the FDA, sorry, and then also the American institution, the American institution, Harvard. So that's the we, whenever they say that right there. So we demonstrate the THC administration leads to inhibition, induction of autophagy, and reduction of tumor growth. And really, the reduction of tumor volume. Autophagy was not evident in normal non-transformed primary astrocytes, which are resistant to cannabinoid-induced cell death. So normal cells, non-transformed cells, those are just healthy cells. And then transformed cells are, of course, cancer cells. So there wasn't any evident effect on the normal cells concerning autophagy being induced, but we're selectively only addressing and inducing autophagy through ER stress, endoplasmic reticular stress, in cancer cells, not regular ones, while it protects regular ones. So cannabinoids are neuroprotectants and really cellular protectants, once you start understanding the endocannabinoid system and how it all works for homeostasis. Anyway, so these findings describe a mechanism by which THC can promote the autophagic cell death, or autophagic death of human cancer cells, and provide evidence that cannabinoid administration may be an effective therapeutic strategy for targeting human cancers. So this was published in the Journal of Clinical Investigation back in 2009. Again, Harvard was involved. I'm going to jump over here real quick and just do some of this little last bit. Considering that no signs of toxicity were observed in the clinical trial of patients in tumor-bearing animals or in the clinical trial patients or in tumor-bearing animals treated intracranially, paratumorally, or intraperiontrally, or intraperitoneally, something like that. Anyway, with THC, and no overt toxic effects have been reported in other clinical trials of cannabinoids used in cancer patients for various applications. So we're talking about nausea, vomiting, pain, using different routes of administration, oral being like swallowed, and then oral mucosal being like sprayed in with a spray on the inside the cheeks or on the tongue, under the tongue. Our findings support that safe, therapeutically efficacious doses of THC may be reached in cancer patients. And that's big for this study to say that, because we have a Harvard researcher here involved in the States saying that there can be therapeutically efficacious doses made for THC, while the Controlled Substances Act that is ran by the DEA but suggested by the Department of Health and Human Services says that it has no therapeutic effect, has no ability to be managed safely by under medical supervision. So this clearly shows that it can be used that way. And so I think that's the third claim in the Schedule 1 status. So that just shows, this shows at least Harvard is now proving the federal government wrong, that it does have therapeutic use and it can be used safely under medical supervision. And all this, as far as the, who is it, the Harvard researcher, this is where they came from. So Cancer Genetics Program, Beth Israel Deaconess Cancer Center, and Department of Medicine, Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center, Harvard Medical. So again, we're connecting some dots between the overseas research team that has a bunch of anti-tumor patents with GW Pharmaceuticals. We have GW Pharmaceuticals, who works with the FDA here, who works with Texas here. And then we have the Harvard researcher. And these are all kind of intertwined. There's no conspiracy between them, but they are all intertwined. You can kind of, like I was saying, connect these dots and be able to show that the United States is also agreeing with all these other places, which would be like Italy and Spain and France. And yeah, that's all right. And it's in this one here. So this is the title: Cannabinoid Action Induces Autophagy-Mediated Cell Death Through Stimulation of ER Stress in Human Glioma Cells. ER is the endoplasmic reticulum. It's responsible for moving parts around the cell so the cell can function properly, proteins and such. And so if you stress out the ER, it's going to turn into an autophagic process where the cell is going to try and recycle itself because it's getting ready to shut down, or it's getting ready to move into apoptosis, which is programmed cell death. So cannabinoids are basically activating the CB1 receptor. The CB1 receptor stresses out the endoplasmic reticulum. The endoplasmic reticulum starts breaking the cell apart, and then that leads to apoptosis, and we're done. So it's a plug-and-play kind of mechanism from most of these, or not most of them, all the ones that I'm seeing as far as these research papers showing how cannabinoids induce cell death. It's always through this endoplasmic reticulum stress and through autophagy ending up in apoptosis. So, yeah, hope y'all enjoyed this. I'm going to try and keep it short. Right now we're at, 8 minutes? What? Anyway. Again, I hope you all enjoyed this. Keep an eye out for the next one. Share this with whoever you think would enjoy this with, as far as doctors and other patients that might be interested in all this kind of stuff. But yeah, I'll leave y'all with this for now. Love y'all. Talk soon. Holla.